Thank you to our previous panel speakers for that extremely insightful and engaging discussion. In India, the much-awaited Joint Parliamentary Committee report on the Indian Personal Data Protection Bill was tabled today in the Indian Parliament. The effectiveness of this piece of legislation will be fundamentally defined by the effectiveness of the Data Protection Authority that will enforce its provisions. This session will discuss how countries should approach how to build a data regulator, what the best practices are, and what lessons can be learned from global experiences. I'd like to welcome the panel speakers, Rahul Mathan, partner at Trilegal, Michael Pisa, policy fellow at the Center for Global Development, Miriam Wimmer, director, Brazilian Data Protection Authority, ANPD, Andrea Helenik, chairwoman, European Data Protection Board, Melinda Klebo, privacy policy director, legislation at Facebook, and the discussion will be moderated by Suyash Rai, deputy director and a fellow at Carnegie India.
Thank you, Priya, for the introductions, and a very warm welcome to my fellow panelists and to those watching this discussion. I'll just take a few minutes to make a few remarks to set the context for today's discussion, and then I'll turn to the experts on the panel. I think the broad context for today's discussion is that for now, it seems that in many countries, the debates around what should be there in the data protection laws has been settled. Although the laws may change over time, many countries have already made data privacy laws. About 128 countries already have data privacy laws, and 20 others have draft laws that are under consideration. And it seems India will also join the club of countries that have comprehensive data privacy laws very, very soon. So much of the action, of the state action on data protection is now going to shift to data protection authorities. It's already shifted in many countries, or the DPAs as they are called, which will implement the data protection laws. So, for the foreseeable future, the DPA will be the main regulatory authorities working in the regulation of digital technologies. On a range of issues, the governments and the legislatures will turn to them as expert bodies for advice. And to varying degrees, depending on jurisdictions, the judiciaries may also defer to them for their decisions as expert bodies. So they will be the main sites of conflict and cooperation around regulation of digital technologies. And how these conflicts and cooperations actually take shape will define to a great extent the relations between humans and digital technologies in the years to come. So there's a very important set of decisions that will be taken and an important set of issues that will be resolved by these authorities or along with these authorities in the years to come. So it's very important to build effective data protection authorities, and this is now a public administration issue. It's no longer a question of legislature. It's no longer primarily a judicial issue. It's a public administration issue. And the effectiveness of public administration, I mean, bodies in public administration depend on many things. What kind of capabilities they're able to build, what kind of constraints they face in their environment, what are the kind of conflicts that they will get into and how those conflicts get resolved, what are the kind of cooperations they're able to achieve with others within the country and elsewhere. So these are the typical public administration issues that we see across various domains, and they will be revisited in new and interesting ways in the context of data protection authorities. So, and they will vary from one context to another. So for example, in Europe, there's a long record, more than 40 years of data protection has been there. GDPR is a significant change to that, but still there's a long history of data protection in Europe. So there are capabilities, there's a rich jurisprudence to refer to. So it's an advantage in some ways, but it's also a disadvantage because there's past dependence and there's a limit to which you can reimagine what data protection should be. So the existing capabilities can sometimes become, constraining also. While countries like Brazil and India, which are building these capabilities basically from scratch, have the ability to think afresh how it needs to be done. and in their context what would work. So each country will find its own path to building data protection authorities and making them effective. There's no grand theory in public administration, and therefore no grand theory of what data protection authority should be. I mean, each one has to figure out its own path. And we are here to learn from five experts who are on the panel, who have thought very deeply about issues of data protection and data protection authorities, and to get some ideas, to get some inspiration about how to think about this. These are early days. It's too early to say what works, what doesn't work. If we say something, history might make a fool of us. But it'll be good to discuss, I mean, what we are seeing, what we're learning. And I mean, I'll start with coming to Dr. Wimmer, who's from ANPD. Brazil has had a very interesting experience of building the data protection authority. After many years of deliberation, they came up with LGPD, which is their data protection law, into 2018. In 2020, finally, in November, they constituted the ANPD, which is the data protection authority there. For 2 years, the authority wasn't set up. It's a very small agency. It is connected to the presidency right now. It's not completely independent as of now. But if I look at their output so far in the last 1 year, they seem to have hit the ground running. Their communications around their strategic plan, the regulatory priorities are clear. They're very specific. They're very sensible. So Dr. Wimmer, if I may, in your opening remarks, could you tell us how ANPD is building its capabilities and how it is choosing its priorities and how it is doing so much with so little? Yeah.
Of course. Thank you very much, Dr. Siyashra. I'd like to begin by thanking you for the invitation to take part in this panel alongside with such distinguished speakers. It's truly a pleasure. And I'm delighted to be able to share some insights about our experience here in Brazil. And hopefully this will be food for thought also for your discussions in India. So as you were mentioning, in fact, here in Brazil, we had almost a decade of discussions leading up to the approval of the General Data Protection Law. And before the law was enacted, in fact, we had a very fragmented approach. We had rules in our constitution, we had sector-specific rules, we had rules for government, we had rules regarding the internet. So in fact, many different approaches towards data processing activities. And as a consequence, we had also a large number of governmental bodies involved with different aspects of data protection, not only at the federal level, but also at the state level. So for instance, we have over 900 local consumer protection bodies who have responsibilities regarding data protection in the field of consumer relations, for instance. We also have public prosecutors acting independently. And Brazil is, in fact, a federation. So we have over 5,560 municipalities. So I think it's very clear what a complex scenario we had before our General Data Protection Law was approved. So the approval of our law and the creation of the National Data Protection Authority, in fact, came in a context in which it was clear that we needed to create greater consistency and more clarity in terms of which business models and practices are legitimate, what are the responsibilities of those organizations that process personal data, and also, of course, how can data subjects exercise their rights. And our law is, in fact, very strongly inspired by the GDPR. It's very similar in many, many aspects. And I think it's fair to say that since 2018, Brazil has taken important steps in terms of creating this more robust, this more solid legal framework to deal with data protection. So we had the approval of a comprehensive data protection law in 2018, the creation of the National DPA last November. We had Supreme Court decisions recognizing the right to informational self-determination. And finally, this year, we had the approval of a constitutional amendment recognizing a fundamental right to data protection. So I think this is all very important. But of course, as you mentioned, an essential part of this framework is, of course, the work of the National Data Protection Authority. And in Brazil, this was quite a challenging discussion because, in fact, the law was approved and then the DPA was only created 2 years later when the law was already in force. And unlike other countries, as you mentioned, in Europe, you have four decades of discussion and experience in data protection. Here in Brazil, we did not, in fact, have a legal structure, an administrative structure within government that dealt specifically with data protection. And also, we don't have a long history of court decisions or administrative decisions to help guide us in interpreting this law. So, in fact, we had to build everything from scratch in the middle of a pandemic. And last November, ANPD had, in fact, only five staff members, which were the five directors nominated by the president after approval by National Congress. So in fact, we had to deal with many challenging issues ranging from, you know, finding out where our physical offices would be located, you know, providing desks and computers, staff members, budget. All this was not available to start with. But of course, in a more strategic manner, I think our main challenge was to provide greater legal certainty in a scenario where there were in fact great expectations as to the role of the DPA. So we did work on trying to be very clear and to communicate in a very transparent manner what our priorities would be. And we started off by drawing up our strategic plan focused on three main pillars. One is the promotion of a personal data protection culture. The second is our regulatory framework. And the third focuses on our own institutional structure. And this concerns staff members, autonomy, budget, and so on. And in terms of the regulatory agenda, we listed 10 different topics to be approached in a prioritary manner over the first 2 years. And these include a wide range of topics, but just to give some examples, the issue of SMEs in Brazil. Most companies are small or medium organizations, and they face unique challenges in terms of adequacy to the general data protection law. The issue of administrative sanctions, for instance, because we also have the powers to apply important penalties such as fines or to demand the cessation of certain data processing activities, dealing with data breaches, data subject rights, international data transfers. And I think that if we look at, you know, this past year of experience, I think perhaps two important lessons emerge from this regulatory agenda. The first is that we need to be selective in order to be effective. It's impossible to deal with all these issues at the same time. So we have to come up with a plan and go by this, you know, in a step-by-step approach. And the second issue, which I think is very important, particularly in Brazil, is the issue of intergovernmental coordination and cooperation. Because in fact, as I mentioned, we have a large number of different organizations in Brazil dealing with different aspects of personal data protection. So what we also worked very hard on during this first year was to enter into formal cooperation agreements with these other governmental bodies in order to provide more consistency of interpretation. So we have agreements with our National Consumer Protection Body, with our National Antitrust Agency, with the Internet Steering Committee, also with the Electoral Superior Court, because we have national elections coming up next year. And of course, data-driven elections are a huge issue everywhere. And I think, you know, in general, we still have many challenges to face, but perhaps the issue of independence and creating a more robust legal structure is one of our main challenges to be faced next year. I think I'd like to stop at this point because I really look forward to listening to the other speakers, but I'd be happy to dive into more details on the next round. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Vimal. I have a few follow-up questions, but I'll come to them later once the everybody has spoken. Dr. Yelinek, I turn to you next. So from your vantage point at the European Data Protection Board, where the main mission is to ensure some consistency in the application of GDPR across countries, you are very close to the problems of, you know, inconsistency across different jurisdictions and how to do better cooperation across different DPAs, because within Europe, each country has its own DPA, but the GDPR is the same and it is being applied by these different DPAs. So in your opening remarks, if you could talk a little bit about cross-border cooperation between DPAs, because the nature of data flows, it's not just what ANPD does in Brazil or what the Austrian Data Protection Authority does in Austria that will shape the effectiveness, but also cooperation across DPAs and making sure that there is some minimum standards that are upheld across jurisdictions, even though each jurisdiction may have its own laws and its own specific set of values. So if you could talk a little bit about this.
Okay, thank you so much for this introduction. Dear ladies and gentlemen, dear fellow panel members, it is my really honor and pleasure to take part in this panel with participants from the four corners of the globe. Our debate takes place at a crucial time, like it was already said. The report of the Special Parliamentary Committee on the Personal Data Protection Bill will be tabled in the Indian Parliament. It's really an important issue at an important time. With this comprehensive bill, India joins the ranks of the many countries around the globe that have put or are putting in place legislation to secure the protection of personal data. In recent years, we have seen that the idea that individuals should have strong and enforceable data protection rights guaranteed by an independent regulator has been gaining ground worldwide. Probably no one better than the Indian Supreme Court in its landmark Puttaswamy judgment articulated the importance of protecting privacy in both the private and the public sector, first and foremost as an indispensable element of human dignity. In Europe, the need to ensure a high level of legal certainty and transparency for both businesses and citizens and the drive for harmonization led to the adoption of the General Data Protection Regulation, or GDPR. The GDPR introduced common rules of the game fit for the opportunities and challenges of the digital age. It creates a level playing field and ensures that data can move easily between operators within Europe and be transferred outside of the European Union while guaranteeing the consistent protection of individuals' personal data. We now have one set of privacy rules that are interpreted in a uniform manner throughout the European Economic Area, i.e. the European Union, Iceland, Norway, and Liechtenstein. The European Data Protection Board was established, as you all know, by the GDPR to play a key role in this process. It is not enough to have robust laws. It is also fundamental that these laws are enforced by independent regulators and that this enforcement happens in a consistent manner throughout a region. That's why the GDPR strengthened the roles and powers of European national data protection authorities as a main interpreter and enforcer of data protection rules. For examples, we are now able to impose fines of 20 million euros or up to 4% of an organization's global turnover, whichever is higher. But our role is not limited to enforcing the GDPR and imposing sanction in case of violation. A very important part of our work, including collectively as a community of privacy regulators in the framework of the European Data Protection Board, is to provide concrete guidance and compliance with key provisions of the GDPR and or their application to new technologies and other new developments. To achieve that, the ETPP can count on the combination of the knowledge and expertise of the national regulators that are close to the situation on the ground in their respective countries, like I am in Austria, with a strong drive towards harmonization and consistency. Such independent authorities, which are easily accessible to citizens and businesses alike, are indeed a key feature of any modern data protection law. And we have read with interest that the Personal Data Protection Bill provides for the establishment of a data protection authority for India. In light of our experience, we can say that having such a body is important both for citizens by providing them with an accessible point of contact to answer their queries, and businesses as an independent supervisory authority can ensure consistent enforcement across cases, as well as through guidelines, the uniform interpretation of the rules. To effectively play its role, it is essential that data protection authority acts with complete independence and impartiality in performing its duties and exercising its powers free from any external influence or direction from any side. A DPA has to be equipped with sufficient human, financial, and technical resources. In Europe, the EEA supervisory authorities ensure the harmonized application of the GDPR throughout the European Economic Area, as well as the consistent protection of all EEA data subjects, regardless of where they live. As data move across borders, the ETPP also looks beyond the geographical limits of the European Economic Area. The global dimension of our work is very important to us, and we invest many resources in this. Having an independent data protection authority in place allows to be part of an international network of regulators and contribute to shape international data protection standards. The ETPP 2021 until 2023 strategy includes a specific chapter dedicated to the global dimension of data protection. Naturally, we as ETPP are available to exchange good practices with our colleagues worldwide, like we did at the last international conference and like we are doing today. And we are also eager to learn from other countries. Through our joint efforts, I'm sure that the convergence of our countries on data protection standards is just a matter of time. And now I thank you for your attention, and I'm eager to take the Q&A afterwards. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Jelinek. In the follow-up, I'll try to draw on your experience as the head of the Austrian Data Protection Authority, which is a little bit more kind of germane to the discussion we're having today, but I'll come to that later. Michael, I turn to you next. You've been doing research in building regulatory capacity in data protection authorities in resource-constrained environments, and I've also been a part of some of those discussions, and you recently came out with a policy note on some of the findings of your research. So tell us what have you found and what are the ideas that you have for building regulatory capacity in such contexts?
Sure, thanks Suyash, and thank you for inviting me and allowing me to participate in the panel. It's been really great hearing from the panelists so far, and I'm really looking forward to the discussion that follows. And I think, like you, we've talked before, I've taken a kind of a circuitous route to working on data protection issues. I don't have a data privacy or legal background, probably unlike all the other panelists. I focused on economic policy issues. And about 2 years ago, I started leading a project for the Center for Global Development called Governing Data for Development. And we focused on how governments could responsibly use newer forms of data, often behavioral data, to generate more timely, granular insights to guide their policies. And we did interviews with probably more than 100 experts working at different facets of data policy. And we generally focus on country policymakers in countries outside the US, EU, and China, who are kind of dominating the global debates on data standards. And we asked, what are the main obstacles you're facing? And almost every expert we spoke to mentioned one of the following three: funding issues and political impetus directed towards improving national statistical systems and modernizing them, lack of technical expertise, and third, regulatory uncertainty around how to comply with new data protection laws. So the first two are kind of longstanding issues with a lot of work being done to kind of address them. And the third, I think, has received much less attention. So that's where we focused and primarily wanted to understand what was driving regulatory uncertainty around data protection and what the effect of that uncertainty was. So we did another number of roundtables, bringing in experts like yourself. And I think just to kind of, quickly summarize some of the key takeaways from our work. Obviously, the key trend over the last 10, 20 years is, the rise of comprehensive data protection frameworks modeled off of the GDPR. In the last decade alone, more than 64 countries have established new comprehensive data protection laws. Most of those countries are in Africa, Asia, and Latin America, and almost all are built around, principles embedded in the GDPR. The catch is that the GDPR is quite complex and broad. And as all your panelists, the framework is not just about laws, right? It's also about institutions and societal norms. So implementing the entire framework is quite an undertaking. And even EU member states, which, as Miriam was pointing out, had many years of kind of jurisprudence built up and administrative infrastructure built up around data protection, have kind of struggled in the early years of implementing the GDPR. And that's to be expected as people figure out how to implement a very new and very complex framework. So the challenge is even greater for resource-constrained governments, and that's where we focused. And just to kind of give you a sense of the scale and the disparity of resources involved, if you look at an organization like the UK ICO, UK's Data Protection Office, they have about 800 permanent staff members. The average number of permanent staff members in a DPA in Africa is less than 20. So the, you know, just the level of resources being assigned to deal with data protection is so vastly different in many countries. And, you know, not surprisingly, when we talk to DPAs, you know, we ask them about the main constraints they faced. Number one, funding. Closely linked to that is the ability to retain and attract technical experts, draw them away from the private sector. And the third, you know, as two of your panelists have mentioned, the importance of autonomy and independence. And that is lacking in many, many countries, right? Many DPAs lack independence from the executive branch or from other agencies. Some are even co-hosted in different ministries. And as Dr. Jelinek mentioned, that really constrains their ability to be effective. And because, you know, of this kind of disparity in resources, what we're seeing in countries that have newly established data protection laws, in many cases, there's this very large gap between laws on the books and laws on the ground. And that not only weakens real protections, it also creates this regulatory uncertainty that, you know, we think will probably hinder useful data innovation by both the private and public sectors. We heard numerous cases where national statistical offices wanted to incorporate administrative data from another agency or mobility data from a telco company or a big tech company into their statistical operations, but they backed out of the project because they were simply unclear about how to comply with new data protection laws. And I think we're at this stage, you know, in the policy community, a very early stage of understanding kind of like the causal pathways through which data regulations affect the country's digital development and economic development. But it's critical that we kind of quickly improve our understanding, because as you mentioned in your intro, these laws and how well they're enforced and how consistently they're enforced kind of set the trajectory for how societies engage with digital ecosystems. And so my hope is, you know, maybe this conversation will touch on this, like trying to develop a more systematic approach of which practices work and don't work. And one of the main difficulties we find in this is thinking about how do you measure this better? How do you measure effective enforcement of data policies, number one, and beyond simply, you know, adding up enforcement actions or looking at check the box compliance? And how do you better measure the value created through trusted data use? So a lot of very smart people thinking about these issues, but I don't think we've kind of cracked it yet. I have some thoughts about where our work leads into like DPA design questions, but I think I'll leave that for the Q&A.
Yeah, thanks, Michael. Thanks. And I think the problems of this resource-constrained countries and this weak DPAs is a global problem, because if this is not addressed to some extent, eventually you may see some kind of jurisdictional arbitrage firms moving to jurisdictions which have weaker enforcement and those kind of problems. And it's been happening in other contexts. It could happen in the context of data protection as well. Now I come to Melinda. As the only, I mean, panelist here who's on the receiving end of the data protection regulations, Facebook now being rebranded as Meta. What has been your experience in terms of different data protection authorities that you've dealt with, and what are your early thoughts on what are the kind of good practices and what could be worth, you know, thinking about trying, you know, when a country is setting up a new data protection authority?
Yes, thank you so much. And thanks to the hosts for having me on this panel. So just a quick setting of context. In my role at Meta, my team focuses on data regulation around the world, which involves not only working on external policy advocacy, but also on bringing insights about global trends and developments back to the company. And just to note that although today I'll be sharing my views from an industry perspective, before I was at Meta, I worked for many years at the Federal Trade Commission in the US, which is the kind of de facto privacy regulator. And I think this is such an important time to be having this conversation because of where the PDP bill currently is in the process, and because of what we are seeing in terms of trends globally around DPAs really thinking about how to best use their resources and learning from prior experiences. So this is a really exciting time. Before we get into the discussion, I'd just like to highlight three things that from an industry perspective are critical to the success of the DPA. And let me say by success, what I'm talking about is three things: building awareness and understanding of the new law, facilitating compliance with the law by providing actionable interpretation and guidance, and actually enforcing the law in a way that is very understanding of the actual technical realities and focuses on kind of the worst practices that exist. First, I want to highlight the importance of working collaboratively and creatively with stakeholders. I think we all understand that the best solutions come through collaboration. It's also really important to developing ongoing relationships with all organizations and to building trust, which will be so essential to the foundations of the DPA. Collaboration can take different forms, such as discussions with individual companies, public consultation processes, or even co-regulatory models. One type of collaboration that I want to highlight and I hope we'll talk about later is regulatory sandboxes. Sandboxes are a really promising innovation that both help companies and the regulator. Facebook worked with the Singapore DPA in a regulatory sandbox, and I'd be happy to share insights about that later. Second, I want to touch on the importance of having a wide range of tools available and of using all of the tools and not just enforcement. So different tools serve different functions, and to achieve the aims of the DPA, it will be important to use all of them. So what tools am I talking about? Most importantly, given that it will be a new law for the country, it will be critical to have consumer and business education. It will also be important to have stakeholder consultations to solicit information and develop a deeper understanding of important issues. It will be key to provide actionable guidance and interpretations of the law. This is invaluable from the company's perspective in terms of understanding specific obligations and the DPA's perspective. Of course, enforcement is an important tool in the toolbox, but it should be risk-based rather than focusing on just kind of indiscriminately focusing on particular practices based on consumer complaints. DPA should really focus on the highest risk practices. And underlying everything, it's important to build a foundation of strong technical expertise and build that knowledge base internally. I think we all know that today's data collection and processing practices are increasingly complex, and so building that expertise from the start will be critical. And finally, I just want to touch on what others have already mentioned is the importance of regulatory cooperation and harmonization. I think we all understand more than ever, we're seeing a range of regulators in the data space, from consumer protection, data protection authorities, competition authorities, safety, and probably others. And the challenge for companies is the risk of diverging regulatory approaches to the same practices. And so it makes it challenging to build for compliance for a company and as well as to plan for the future. Given this, it's going to be really important to have clarity about the roles of various regulators, consistency in approaches, collaboration among regulators. And I will note that this is important not just within domestic situations within a particular country, but internationally as well. And we've seen really strong relationships popping up around the world in terms of communities of data protection regulators, information sharing, best practices. And I can say more than ever that we're seeing references to what's going on in particular countries by other regulators, standard bearers being the UK, Singapore, other places around the world that are really setting down markers that everyone is looking to. And so we are seeing that pollination already, which is great. I'll leave it there and I look forward to the discussion.
Thank you. Thank you, Melinda. I'll come back to you. I mean, Rahul, I come to you last. I took the liberty, I'm sorry, because you are the closest to us here. So as someone who's very deeply familiar with the Indian digital economy and the law that is taking shape now, and you've also contributed to those discussions for years now, what do you think should be the approach that India takes to building the data protection authority, and what could we do differently in terms of the regulatory approach from what you see elsewhere? You know, what could be novel about how India does it?
Thanks, Suyash. And that was quite a liberty, because it coming at the end of such an illustrious panel means there's scant little left to say. But I'm gonna try my best. And just pulling together a lot of the comments that people have said so far, I think, you know, I was particularly struck by what Dr. Wimmer said. I've heard this by many regulatory data protection authorities, which is you've got to be selective to be effective. And I think let's not be novel about that. Let the Indian regulator be selective, pick the cases that are actually going to shape the direction of the precedents, and use those cases and not do the scattergun approach that I think Melinda was speaking about. I think the other concern that I have is that, as you've mentioned, as other people have mentioned, India just does not have a jurisprudence in data protection. Up until 3 years ago, we weren't even sure that we had a fundamental right to privacy. And then when the Supreme Court articulated that, that sort of, it's not to say that we don't have a jurisprudence in privacy, but data protection is very different. And so I think, as much as it is important to get this right, there is an urgency to get the regulator up in place. But I think we've got to urgently create the regulator and give the regulator the resources that it requires. But at the same time, allow the regulator to build out the precedent in the manner that it is required. And so there's confluence of both the urgency as well as the need to be measured about this that. I think we need to think about. And then, you know, on the resources point, I think every data protection authority I've spoken to, no matter how large their office is, says it's not large enough. So I don't think the solution is really, throwing more and more bodies at it. It could be, but I think just regardless of how many bodies you throw at it, we are 1.3 billion people, and every single one of them has an opportunity to raise a claim for data protection violation. And I don't suspect that if we go down that path, we're going to find a useful solution. So you asked me to be novel, and I think one of the things that India has done. So first of all, I think your point on path dependence is really well taken. I think there is a risk to being path dependent. I would argue that we have already started out in our privacy journey by being path dependent because our data protection law is based largely on the GDPR. The greater risk at this point in time is to create a data protection authority that is based on European data protection authorities, because Europe has got 30 years of jurisprudence. Europe has built this data protection authority from these regulators from before the big data moment. And so they could ease into dealing with big data issues. We don't have that luxury. We're hitting the ground running. We're dealing with vast amounts of data. We're dealing with data pervading every aspect of society. I've got industrial clients and they have data protection issues, even though they're in an entirely B2B space. So we've got to think differently. And if there's one thing that India has done in the recent years is evolve a sort of a techno-legal approach. We've done this in the context of portability. We've got portability frameworks in the financial services sector that are a techno-legal solution. And recently, Niti Aayog, the government think tank, released an online dispute resolution report, which talks about innovative ways in which dispute resolution can take place online. I would strongly urge the Data Protection Authority to think through those sorts of approaches. I don't, off the top of my head, have answers as to what the specifics are. But I think we've got to start leveraging those sorts of approaches. I think there's no doubt that we need resources. We may not be able to staff the authority with the resources in-house, but we should think innovatively about clerkships and about secondments. I think if anything, over the last 5 years, we've built a very rich community in India in the data protection space. And there are innovative ways in which we can tap into those resources, even if they don't necessarily sit within the data protection authority. And I guess the last point I'll make is that, look, we are dealing with a area of regulation that is changing very, very rapidly. I know it's taken us 10 years to get this data protection law in place. But literally every month we're going to find a new thing to deal with. And I don't think that we can be slow about the way in which we issue our directions and make pronouncements, issue regulations. we've got to find a quicker way to regulate at the speed of the internet. And the speed of the internet today is very, very fast. It's much faster than the speed of regulation and legislation. So I have long written and argued about having principle-based legislation. So have principle-based regulations. And I think the PDP bill, the draft that I believe has been tabled before Parliament, is very much based on the European principles of principle-based regulation. But I think we've got to then take that to the next step, which is allow some sort of regulatory measures by which those principles can be very quickly reflected into directions and guidelines so that you can give business the certainty it needs. I think there's nothing worse than having a principle that's interpreted in 5 or 10 different ways, because then that principle is actually completely meaningless. So how do we find a way in which to translate this principle-based legislation that hopefully the Parliament will enact into law into concrete regulatory steps so that in every sector, every narrow, minute sector, business has certainty as to what they can do and what they can't do. And then, you know, we can deal with all the other things, enforcement and all of those things later. But I think these would in my mind, be the things that our regulator needs to focus on.
Thank you, Rahul. And I think this last point that you made, I just want to pick up on it and maybe throw a follow-up question back to you. That this question of going from principles to specific expectations, specific obligations that the firms can understand and comply with, how would you sort of create it? Like, because it's each industry will have its own context. So the data protection law has the code of practice possibility, where code of practices are developed by a practitioner and approved by the data protection authority. So it's kind of a co-development process of the regulatory specific codes which are actually to be followed, while the principles are there in the law. So would that be something which could work, or what could be the mechanism to create specificity out from the principles?
No, absolutely. I think that's really what I was thinking about. I think the codes of practices offer us an opportunity to be agile in this manner. And so the principles talk generally about how the law will apply across sector, and then we should encourage the creation of self-regulatory organizations that can look at the interests of a particular segment or sector of the industry, propose a framing which says that, look, I think this is the way this needs to apply to, I don't know, the digital map making industry. Then when you have those principles articulated, I think all the DPA needs to do at that point in time is take a look at it and see, you know, this SRO, are they being self-serving in what they're doing? Are they actually checking all the boxes? It's a lot easier than the DPA having to think through. And you know, I think someone mentioned it, that this is a highly technical area. So to expect the DPA, which is the general regulator, to build technical expertise in every minute area of technology is too much. But you can expect the Data Protection Authority, if presented with a set of regulations that have been formulated by subject matter experts, to then look at it and say, yeah, look, this seems to check all the boxes. I don't think you've addressed, I don't know, use limitation or one of those principles. Can you spend a little more to ensure that that is sorted out? That may be one way to do this. But at the same time, I think we've also got to understand that say that digital map making sectoral regulation that came out, tomorrow we'll have, I don't know, drones making maps. And then there's a third dimension to think about. And then we've got to worry about something new. We shouldn't be afraid to actually go back to the regulation that we passed, even if it was just 2 months ago, and say, we've got an update. We've got to now address this new issue. It's a lot of work, I know. But I don't know if a 6+1 member committee is ever going to be able to do this amount of work. But we've got to think in this way in order for the regulator to be current at all times.
Yeah, I think we need a completely different regulatory approach and imagination. And therefore, I think that path dependence is not such a great advantage, because things have changed so much in the last 4-5 years that if you go with this approach of making a regulation, revising it, you will be behind the curve every time. So you need to find a completely different approach, perhaps. Dr. Bimar, I come to you with a follow-up question. You basically drawing on a point that you made about the complexity of the Brazilian public administration landscape. You've got so many sector-specific regulators, and this is a horizontal law. So it will be applied across those sectors. So you have to coordinate with them. So Of course, one question is a factual question. Do you have a veto over the interpretation of the LGPD, or can there be conflict, and how are the conflicts resolved? The other question is a larger question about the digital transformation that countries like Brazil and India are going through. And the state is a major processor of personal data. And I was looking, and LGPD doesn't actually empower you to enforce, give penalties to state authorities. And even if there was such a power, it wouldn't have been particularly effective in the case of government authorities anyway. So what are the kind of instruments that you use? What are the kind of coordination, nudges, what kind of mechanism do you use to make sure that the government's processing of personal data is compliant to the extent possible with LGPD? So the two-part question, but both to do with government authorities.
Thank you. Those are great questions. And coming to your first one, in fact, ANPD has the final authority to interpret the law within public administration. Of course, the judiciary branch can review our decisions, but the LGPD is to be interpreted finally by us. Of course, other bodies can interpret their own laws, and you know, the risk of conflict interpretations is not completely set aside. But in fact, we do have this central role of sort of organizing the ecosystem. And that's in fact the reason why we're working so hard to create these formal cooperation arrangements in order to allow us to come to uniform positions and try to minimize this risk of divergent interpretations as to the legality or the legitimacy of certain data processing activities. So that's the first point. The second one, I think, is very interesting because, in fact, of course, data processing by the government itself is a very important part of data protection, right? And here in Brazil, we are, in fact, not allowed to apply fines to governmental bodies. Yeah. Because in our organization, it wouldn't really make sense. It would be equivalent to taking money out of one pocket and putting it into the other. Right. But we are allowed to apply other sort of sanctions that range from warnings, name and shame approaches, blocking of personal data, partial or total prohibition of activities related to data processing. So we are entitled to apply these other administrative sanctions. And it's important to note that also other governmental bodies that are responsible for ensuring that civil servants or public officials comply with the law are also entitled to act in many, many circumstances. They are allowed also to investigate officials personally if they have, in fact, committed any illegal actions related to data processing activities. But of course, it is very challenging. And I think our approach at this point in time has been more geared towards a responsive approach in terms of trying to understand the motivations of different public organizations, which in principle are not, they don't mean to do things wrong, but many times they are not aware of the rules or they don't have sufficient resources to carry out the law as it should be. So we have also been trying to adopt this responsive approach based on a more dialogue way of dealing with public bodies, establishing, for example, timeframes for them to correct their activities or demanding data protection impact assessments in order to allow them to gradually bring their activities in line with the LGPD. But of course, public bodies are also subject to sanctions, not only in the administrative branch, but also by the judiciary itself.
Thanks. Very specific and very clear answer. Thank you so much. Dr. Jelinek, I want to ask you about your experience. You became the head of the Austrian Data Protection Authority back in 2014. You've seen this transition to the brave new world of GDPR. Tell us about the capacity challenges that you faced when the GDPR came into force. And how are those challenges addressed, especially the Austrian Data Protection Authority that you are leading in? What did you have to do differently to deal with this large, complex regulation and enforcement?
Thank you for this question. In Austria, there has already been existing a data protection law nearly 40 years. And we already had powers to make decisions. But when I arrived at the Data Protection Authority, we were about 21 people. Now we are 51 people. And the complaints didn't double, didn't triple, but were about from 300 up to 2,500, because the people got more aware of their rights and how to make a complaint. And I think it's really important to raise the awareness of the people about their data protection rights. You will see also in India, if the people are aware of their rights, it will also be a question of communication of the data protection authority to tell the people on the one hand what their opportunities are, and on the other hand, also to tell the companies what their responsibilities are, especially towards their people, towards the data subjects. And I think this is really important because each CEO of any company is also a data subject, him or herself. So all of the people are wearing two hats. That's one of the experiences. The other experience is, it's not only a question of quantity, it's also a question of quality. And one of the main assets of the GDPR, and this is for all countries within the European Economic Area, is that with the entering into application of the GDPR, the complainant and also the companies, when you have a big company like Melinda's company is, you have just one interlocutor. The complainant has one interlocutor, that's the data protection authority in his or her home country, and the company also has just one interlocutor, and that's the supervisory authority where the main establishment of the business is. And I think it's really important that you have these two opportunities for the businesses and for the data subjects, because it's an advantage for both of them, and because they just have one interlocutor, and for businesses, I think it's really an advantage to have one set of rules for many countries like it is in the European Economic Area, because before the GDPR, it was like a puzzle, and you had the directive, but the interpretation of the directive was in the laws of each and each country, and there were divergences. So, and now we have the GDPR and the interpretation of the GDPR, and we look as ETPP into the consistent application of the GDPR. It's up to us, it's up to the supervisory authority. And as ETPP, we are doing that, what either Rahul and also Melinda said, we are giving guidance for the companies, we are making public consultations, and we are making stakeholder events. So we try to put all these issues together. So just a short wrap up of what we do in Austria, what we've done in Austria, and what we're doing within the European context and within the European community. And I think it's really important that we work together on these big or also small cross-border cases. We meanwhile resolved more than 300 cross-border cases. And I think it's really important to notice that though the regulators are the national regulators, but the outcome of the national proceedings and complaints also have an effect of all the for all the other countries, because you have to interpret the GDPR in the consistent and same way. Does this meet your question?
Yes, it's a very good and comprehensive answer. Just one quick question to you. Out of the 50 plus employees at the Austrian Data Protection Authority, how many were lawyers?
29.
That's what I think. Most data protection authorities have many lawyers because they're always dealing with complaints. A lot of complaints.
And all these, lawyers are. Some of them are just dealing with fines, but these are only a few of them, four, and the others are dealing on national and international cases, both to foster the understanding of the cross-border cooperation, because you know each national case can immediately come to an international, so it is important to work together to cooperate in the supervisory authorities on a daily basis. I think this cooperation is one of the most important issues within the European Economic Area, that we cooperate on a daily basis.
Dr. Wimmer, what are the kind of capabilities that, I mean, you have skill sets in terms of the people working at ANPD? So how many lawyers, people in technology background, economists,
Now, we actually have a mixed background, and in fact, most of our staff members are in fact civil servants that come from different bodies within public administration. So we have people with technical backgrounds, with legal backgrounds, we have economists, we have people with experience with antitrust, with consumer relations, people from regulatory agencies, which in fact is my case. I worked at the telecom regulator previously. So it's been very interesting learning from these different backgrounds and also experiences.
And how many people work right now at NPD?
We currently have around 50 staff members, including the five directors. So it's not huge considering we have 230 million inhabitants, but I think it's enough to get started.
Thank you. Thank you. Belinda, a question to you. So this issue has come up previously also in the discussion of doing consultations, learning from the industry, working together. You know, in the public administration jargon is called collaborative rationality, but you don't have to use that. But what are the kind of mechanisms that you've seen of BPAs on an ongoing basis interacting and, you know, learning from, and I mean, while being independent, of course, of what is changing and how and responding to those changes, specific mechanisms that seem to be having, at least early days, but seem to be having some effect in the learning and decisions of these authorities?
Yeah, so a few examples of things that we're seeing. One is the willingness of the regulator to have kind of an open door to companies to come in, build that trust. Companies can come in and say, we're considering this product or this change. How does this, you know, how would you view this kind of thing? Can we get some guidance about whether this would comply or what changes might make sense given the legal framework here? And really building that very trusted relationship from the beginning where companies are incentivized and feel like they can come in and share information early on before there might be problems down the road. I think that benefits everyone in the relationship. So I think that's one really important aspect. But then I think we also have seen a recognition among regulators that they need to rely on the expertise and the insights of folks in industry and in civil society and in academia. And so through open consultations around, I'll just use a recent example that has been really important for our company has been the UK's leadership on the age appropriate design code, which is, you know, obviously a very important issue in terms of youth data protection, protecting youth data. And so as part of that consultation, which took a long time and really, delve deep into beyond just the text of the GDPR, but how do you implement youth related protections in an age appropriate way in the best interest of the child? The regulator sought input from a range of experts, from companies, academics, child safety and wellness experts, and really integrated all of that input into very specific recommendations. So undergoing that kind of deep collaborative information gathering, and I think that helps the regulator build expertise in a particular area, and also helps build kind of the trust among other folks in the ecosystem. So I would say that's another great tool that DPAs can use as they're trying to kind of build their expertise and build relationships.
Thanks. Dr. Vimar, the NPD came out with this request for comments on a couple of issues. And I mean, just describe to us the experience, because I mean, my general belief, if you have an open request of comments, you'll have lots of comments, and then you will be swamped with having to, tell the good quality comment from the other comments, and there has to be some structured process. But you had a very open request for comments. How did it work? Did you actually learn? Was it helpful? I mean, this is of course before the consultation and draft and all of that.
Right. It is, in fact, a very challenging process. And personally, I've been working in government for the past 15 years and gone through many of these experiences. And I think for the regulator, it's always important to hear different points of view, because, of course, we are not always right. We are not always able to understand the whole picture. So what we have been doing at ANPD is the following. We are legally required to go through formal public consultations and public hearings. But since the issues are so complex and they affect such a wide range of activities, we have had sort of pre-formal consultation processes like requests for comments, like meetings with experts that we also play live on YouTube, for instance. So over this past year, we've had over 30 hours of live discussions that are available on the internet to dive deeper into specific topics that will be the object of regulation in the future. So personally, I think that both processes are very interesting. I think I can learn more when I have a face-to-face discussion with experts rather than diving through 3,000 comments that are made in a written form through a public formal consultation. But of course, both mechanisms are important. And since we have a small team, it is in fact very challenging, very time consuming to go through these numerous comments and separate what is useful and what is not useful. We are, however, legally required to do so. So in fact, we have received, I think, over 3,000 comments throughout this year. And our team, our small team, is in fact required to read each of them and to sort of reply and say if they were accepted or not accepted, and take them into consideration in our formal regulatory process. I think when we have a larger team, it may be helpful. Sometimes I think that we need AI to help us shift through these contributions in a more effective manner. Yes, yes. But I think this is in fact our legal requirement currently, and we're doing our best to deal with this in a responsible manner.
Is even the request for comments also a legal requirement, or only the consultation for on the draft?
The legal requirement is only for the consultation on the draft and for the public hearings on the draft. But we think it is useful to have a note for comments before to allow us to make less mistakes when we finally come up with a draft.
Now, just a quick question for you and Dr. Jelinek. I think we are almost towards the end of the allotted time. Are you collaborating with other academic institutions or civil society organizations of a certain stature to leverage their capacities to do some of this research and some of this analysis for you so that it feeds into your work on an ongoing basis? Are there formal collaborations of the type?
There are formal collaborations in Austria and informal collaborations. And we are also, what we are doing is we are contributing to each and every legal proposal which intends to have a data protection impact. This is really important that we contribute on that. And at the level of the European Data Protection Board, we are on a constant cooperation and especially exchange of views with other authorities, and not only data protection authorities, and also the stakeholders. And especially with those who are in cooperation and special legal cooperation, like Forum Europe and so. And I think it's really important to have not only the sectors, but on a horizontal level, all the industry. Melinda knows this, that we are contributing to those organizations, and I think it's quite important, not only and especially not always to special companies, because you can't meet every company, and you also have to be impartial to not only to the big ones, but especially also to the small ones.
Thank you.
Right. And in our case, just catching on to what Dr. Jelinek was saying, we don't yet have formal cooperations with academic institutions, but we do have an interesting feature in Brazil, which is a multi-stakeholder advisory board connected to ANPD. So it's made up of 23 members. It includes government, academia, civil society, also the business community, labor unions, and so on. And this is, in fact, a very representative and very important board because, in fact, as Dr. Jelinek was saying, we can't meet with each organization individually, but when we have a representative board that's sort of a melting pot for ideas to be discussed and for the main topics to be brought up, this is in fact very useful for us to identify priorities and also problems. Our board is still being set up. It was also created this year, but we have a very representative group of experts, and we very much look forward to counting on their support.
Yeah, I think that's a very useful way to have an ongoing arrangement. Yes.
One additional remark, if you allow me. Panels like this are one of the most important opportunity to exchange point of views and experiences and best practices. I think it's really important to exchange this. And I would appreciate if you could do it in person, because if you do it in person, you know even more, and one word follows the other, and it's very much more interactive than it is now.
Yes, it's more fun also, you become friends.
Yes, it's more fun too.
Yeah, I think you're out of time. But Rahul, I'm going to put you in a spot, and you've been deeply engaged in the privacy debates in India, law. Now you're thinking about the Data Protection Authority. Tell me two things that you learned in the discussion today that you didn't know already about Data Protection Authority and what India should do. Two ideas that you got. Or even if one.
You're really, really putting me in a spot there. I mean, look, I think the point that Dr. Wimmer made around having that board, a multi-stakeholder board associated with that, I thought that was a really good idea. And I think in my comments I mentioned that we should be thinking about doing clerkships and things like that. That may be too informal, and that also may not be at the correct level of stature of input that you need. And so to constitute a multi-stakeholder board and use it effectively, I would really be interested in understanding how that would actually work in practice. That to me sounds like a really good step that India could take, in a sense, to leapfrog a lot of these issues that we don't have the luxury of many years of precedent for. I hadn't heard of this before, so that was the one that.
Thank you, and sorry to put you in a spot. So we had a very good discussion. I actually learned a lot because I'm not an expert in this area, so I learned even more. And this is, as I said earlier, it's early days for Data Protection Authorities. And I want to end on a philosophical note. That the philosopher John Anderson once wrote that of a social or political institution, you shouldn't ask what purpose it serves, but what conflicts is it the site for? No? What are the kind of conflicts that is going to shape that institution? And I think when it comes to data protection authorities, this couldn't be more true. There are going to be many, many conflicts in the years to come, and many opportunities for collaboration also. And they will shape what data protection authorities become. It's not going to be an agency in a box that you can just unravel. These are high stakes games. There are very, very, high powered incentives in place. And there is going to be a trial by fire, and some data protection authorities will come out stronger because they will not be killed, and others may not have that. So let's see how it goes, and hopefully in India we'll have a strong data protection authority in the years to come. Thank you all. Thank you for joining us today and giving us so much time and so many good ideas for us in India and also people watching elsewhere. Thank you.